started and started.
So, another application is part of speech time. I hope everyone is aware of this. So, yeah, essentially, there are three blocks to the architecture that is used here. One is CNN, another is by LSTM, and last one is CRF, conditional random forest. So, CNNs are basically, I'll explain each of them in detail, but this is used to give you a word embedding based on character level convolutions. Yeah, that's character level convolutions. Bi-LSTM captures the interdependency between adjacent words, and CRF captures rules like a noun is always followed by an adjective. And that a noun cannot be followed by an organization. So, yeah. So let's go into the details. I was doing it for NER, so I'm the part of speech. I'm not really. And most of my examples will pertain to NER. So the model is pretty simple for character level. So essentially what you do here is, supposing you have a word, say playing, I think the same example is used in the paper also. So for each character, and I think you use some padding also. Yeah, because these are convolutions. So for each character, you randomly sample from a matrix, and the values of the matrix, I think, are uniformly sampled. This is not mentioned in this paper. The paper which this refers to mentions that the values of the matrix. So what happens is, like Kristen was explaining that day, you take 26 small alphabets, 26 big alphabets, 10 digits, and some punctuation. So let's stick to this, leave the punctuation. So our matrix is essentially 62 into whatever dimension, some dimension. I'm not sure if it results in the dimension of the word, but some dimension B. And essentially, this is the matrix whose values are sampled from the uniform distribution. Okay, now say for plane, so you have for plane, you have a row vector. Then essentially you convolve over.
What is D there?
D is any number, basically the dimension of the character embedding that you choose.
But that's like a parameter, you can say.
For every word, it's the same.
Huh. It has to be the same throughout the
word. Every word will be encoded in that dimension.
Okay. I'm not sure right now. I mean, I have to think about this, but I'm not sure if D is ultimately the, because I think it varies with the convolutions. I'm not sure if D is finally the dimension of the word embedding. But let's see. Okay. So yeah. So essentially, you use convolutions and you convolve over vectors. So one at a time.
I'm sorry, that is the 64 digitality, whatever all we can say.
This is a D cross one vector.
But the sum of the whole matrix is 62 into D, right? No.
So 62 into D, so you have A, B to Z, A to Z, 0 to 9. And what you do is, for each of that, you have a D sized vector. That's what I wanted. Say with the 62 cross D. So what you do is, for capital B, you draw from here randomly, and you randomly sample up, not random sampling. You basically draw a vector here pertaining to B. That's what I wanted to say. Clear? No? Okay. So each of those vectors is d cross 1. And so essentially you perform convolutions. The filter size is d cross whatever you want to take, I think. D cross 3 you can take, I guess. Your d cross 5, whatever you want to take. And what happens is, so each of these convolutions will give you a vector, right? And then what you do is, just a second. And then what you do is you take the max of these. So this is actually taking max over time. Okay, let me explain the problem. So this is one convolution filter that you're applying and taking the max. Now you apply, say, k convolution filters and you obtain a k cross 1 embedding for it. Embedding for the word. Is that clear? So this is one convolution that you apply. You get a vector, you take the max, you get one value right out of it, one scalar value. Now you apply k convolutions like this, and then you get a k cross 1 vector for the word. So this is how character level convolutions work.
What is k convolution over there? Like what operations?
K convolutions mean k filters. You apply one filter, then you apply another filter, then you apply another filter.
Okay, that d cross 3 is one filter.
Huh, exactly.
So one thing that so something like d cross 3
yeah.
cross k, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that something like d cross 3 cross k?
Huh. Then one, if you do
k
it.
Chat, like you can.
K chat. I'm not very familiar with convolution terminology.
Okay.
1D convolutions?
Did you want to have with them? Like, so you convolve around what text, words or character?
Characters.
Okay, so it should be only convolution.
I mean, what you are essentially doing is you capture this one and this one.
So it's one thing, you just do text.
Huh. Okay, so is this clear? Bi-directional is so.
So you take a max over time, where is that?
Huh. Now they say, and in the slide that I've shared, or another supplemental material that I've shared, they say that max over time is, so you take one convolution, okay, how do I say this? So you, what you do is, so supposedly it's d cross 3. So you get, just a second, so you get one value. From this, you get another value. You slide the filter across the vectors, right? So they say that it's and yet then you take the max. So this is
then you should sum it up. No? So like convolution actually means you convolve,
mm-hmm.
then you sum it up with your one value.
Exactly. This is after summation. So after one convolution, after one pass of the filter, you get this value. After another pass of the same filter, you get this value. Then till you reach the end of the word, and then you take the max over all the passes.
Okay.
This is what it is.
Maximum scalar value.
Maximum?
Scalar value.
Maximum scalar, you will get one maximum scalar value. Now this is when you applied one filter to it. When you apply the second filter, you will get another value.
So it's just convolution, no other activation. Is there? Sure.
I mean, there must be activation. Just a second. I don't think any activation.
I think it's max pooling. What you're doing, max pooling over time is the activation. Max over time.
It's max actually, because in images you take the max over, say this is after convolution, you take the max over this, and this is 1D, so you, so this is essentially max.
That is
over.
not activation.
It's not activation.
Huh?
It's not activation.
it's pooling.
So you convolve with one filter and then you convolve with second filter.
Okay.
Is the first and second filter the same or with the other dimensions?
I think they should be different.
And how many types are there? I mean, if they're different, like how many variants?
One
would be decrossed, one would be decrossed, right?
No, they have to be the same size, I guess.
I think that's why you're taking pooling, I guess, to ignore that dependency.
Yeah, I'm thinking.
Because you'll get various lengths, and you know, you will take one value.
Probably you'll pad it with zeros. That's actually what they do with 1D convolutions, not any convolution.
But the output is only scalar value, right? So it doesn't matter what is the length of that.
You have a point.
Anyway, you're pooling.
Because if you convolve it once with D cross 3, anyway, you're getting a scalar. And if you convolve again with D cross 5, you're getting again a scalar. I have not checked this properly. I will check this and let you know. Okay, so. Yeah, so bi-directional LSTMs, everybody must be aware, so essentially this is one LSTM block I'm not going to go into the details. So this is one LSTM block, another, and you get, in the forward pass you get some hidden states, in the backward pass you get some, and the inputs are word embeddings. Word embedding 1. Whatever the sentence, you feed a sentence. So word embedding 1, 2, say the sentence is, I think if this has to be some fixed size, but okay. Say we are taking a certain. So for each, for the forward pass, you get a hidden embedding. For the backward pass, you get a hidden embedding. And then you can concatenate the two, basically. Is this clear? So CRF, conditional random fields. So essentially, so supposingly Z1 till Zn is the text that we gave to the entity recognizer, whatever. And Y1, Y2 till Yn are the corresponding labels. So, yeah, the notation that they have used is, okay, first let me write the formulas and I'll explain you the So what happens is, what is this? Why? This is the, I think this is the set of all possible annotations that can be given to this sequence. So the probability is defined like this, where this y array is okay, so what this is essentially doing is, this is taking pairs at a time. So, Z1, Z2, Zn. So, this takes pairs at a time. Z1, Z2, Z2, Z3, till Zn minus 1, Zn. And then it calculates the probability like this. And this is basically expressed like this. It's, Xi is actually the exponential, and this this weight matrix is dependent on. This weight matrix is learnable. This bias is learnable, and Zi.
Bias is learnable.
Bias
is learnable.
Just like I'm not really able to understand why this Zeta is.
What is it?
Z is
probabilities.
No, Z are the labels. Z are the words actually. Z are the word embeddings. The concatenation of H1, H2 that you got in Bi-directional. These are those. And these are labels.
Y dash?
So this is a general function. They want to say that y dash y, like the upper in y dash and y belong to this basically. Y and they are basically in y. Y is the set of all possible annotations which can be allotted to Z1, Z2, Z2 till Zn. This is like, like softmax, you calculate exponential upon summation of exponential. Here what you are doing is, so essentially what you, roughly the idea is that probability of Y given Z is nothing but the product that the product of probability of I and Y given Y is the label, roughly the idea is you basically take these pairs and want to see, I don't want to mess this up, but I think it's this. So the idea is that this label set can be assigned to this set of word embeddings with this probability. Something like this. This was a rough idea that I had. So, yeah, I know it's a bit unclear, but okay.
Is it trainable with SGD?
I mean, not SGD, not gradient descent, gradient ascent, I guess. I'm not seeing the code exactly how they are doing it, but so essentially they are, okay, I'll get to that. So they're not using any loss, they are aiming to maximize the probability of
So
it can be trained by gradient descent,
but either it takes the properties of the and then like refines those well. CRF is a post processing step, right? I mean, once you get the properties from the network, then you do something on that. I mean, either you
CNN is just there to get the word embeddings, just that. Yeah. Why post processing?
ZI, which you get from Bi-LSTM, you then use post processing by CRF.
Yeah, maybe clean that up or like.
CRF is just there to establish dependencies. Dependencies meaning, like I told you, a noun is followed by an adjective, or noun cannot be followed by an organization. Rules like this. I also don't have much idea about CRFs, but yeah, like. This has understood somehow.
That is also some kind of post-processing. I mean, you're trying, you already know.
I don't
like those are kind of the rules and you're trying to.
Okay. Like sort of an enhancer that it is.
Kind of a boosting algorithm.
Oh, yeah.
It's not an algorithm, but it's trainable.
Hi, it's trainable. Because these W's and these you train multiply. So ultimately you want to maximize this F. And this K runs over the training set. So, yeah, that's what you want to do. You want to maximize this. And I thought about this. So I thought about this. Maximizing this doesn't make sense until and unless it has a bounded value. And this is bounded because this is ultimately log of product of probabilities, right? And since this cannot exceed 1, the product of probabilities can never exceed 1, so this will never exceed 0. Yeah, log is an increasing function. So the maximum value that we can have is 0. And you can actually apply gradient descent also. If you reverse the problem, you minimize the negative orders. Then you can apply gradient descent. For this, you can gradient ascent maybe. Yeah. I mean, instead of subtracting the gradient, you add the gradient. So you get to the maximum.
Yeah.
This part, I'm sorry, I was not able to explain properly. There's a lot of notation here, that's why I got confused. But the idea is that the probability with which this label set can be assigned to this set of word embeddings, that means the text, is the product of the probabilities that each pair is feasible. Something like that. Yeah, that's what I understood. Any questions?
Absolutely.